My name is Cheryl Wunsch, and I'm so happy to be the host for this presentation, Goldilocks and the Three Orthodoxies, Traditional Responses to Same-Sex Relationships with Rabbi Steven Greenberg. Any further ado, please allow me to introduce our presenter for this morning's topic. Rabbi Steven Greenberg is an Orthodox ordained educator, writer, and speaker who has led the call for LGBTQ inclusion in the Orthodox world. He is the author of the award-winning book, Wrestling with God and Men, Homosexuality in the Jewish Tradition. And I'm going to put a link to that book in the chat now. And for this book, he won the Koret Jewish Book Award for Philosophy and Thought in 2005. Rabbi Greenberg is also a founder of the Jerusalem Open House, Jerusalem's first gay and lesbian community center, and is currently a faculty member of the Hartman Institute of North America. He is the founding director of Eshel, an Orthodox LGBT community support, education, and advocacy organization, and he lives with his partner, Stephen Goldstein, and daughter Amalia in Boston. So please help me welcome Rabbi Steven Greenberg.
Thank you, Cantor Wunsch. I so appreciate being introduced in Canada in particular, because one of my fondest memories is that a bunch of years ago, I was called up by a lawyer in the Canadian community that was working hard to get same-sex marriage passed, and asked me for an affidavit, and I'm proudly part of the Canadian effort to achieve same-sex marriage. So this morning, that momentary frame, I'm happy to turn everybody at some point to share the affidavit at some point, but that's not for today. What I want to do is talk about how Orthodoxy has shaped a discourse around same-sex marriage and relationship. And as you'll note, I wrote a book about this, and so I'm not going to address the deeper halachic questions which have to be addressed. And though at the end of this, you will see a list of strategies that the Orthodox community is using, I want to be very pragmatic in our hour. So what I'm going to share is over the past 10 years, what has gone on in the Orthodox community on this issue. There's a little bit of history that will be shaped 10 years or 20 years before that, but mostly I'm attempting to shape a contemporary portrayal of the three bowls of porridge that that Goldilocks has to choose from in defining a response to same-sex relationships and experience. And so we're gonna begin with me sharing, if I can, my screen, and moving directly to the material. Okay, so what you see in front of you is a wedding I did in 2010. Actually, it was 2011. It was November 10th. And I had been asked to do weddings as the first openly gay Orthodox rabbi. I came out in 1999. For a decade or more, and just couldn't feel like there was any real way that was going to make any sense to the Orthodox community. And finally, after being pressured and feeling like I wasn't really offering a life arc for Orthodox gay Jews who wanted to actually move forward in their lives, and that it was irresponsible not to, I decided to do it on the condition that we didn't really publicize this. Well, of course, somebody decided to put this on his blog. In the end, within days, if not hours, images like this were all over the internet. And on December 5th, less than a month after that, 100 Orthodox rabbis gathered to describe my having conducted a same-sex commitment ceremony, defined me no longer as Orthodox. Jewish tradition unequivocally teaches that marriage can only exist as a union between a man and a woman So the exclusion of a homosexual relationship is a distortion of Torah to confound that sacred principle, and we strongly object to this desecration of Torah values and the subsequent misleading reportage. In other words, the very notion that an Orthodox rabbi had performed a same-sex commitment ceremony, and I argued at the time that I was not doing a kiddushin. I was essentially using Orthodox halachic frameworks for addressing committed loving relationship between two men or two women. Somehow that did not succeed in convincing anybody, or at least most people in the Orthodox community, that this was something that they could get behind. The reason I bring this in is because in around 2010, a little bit before, the field around Orthodoxy's response to homosexuality became heated up. And largely, no doubt, having to do with efforts and success in the larger social world around same-sex relationship. The material, the Orthodox material that's probably most central to the, you know, I would say the broad-based Orthodox response appeared, let me just get you the right text here because I'm moving ahead somehow accidentally. There we are, right here. So there was something in 2011 in December. Remember, the wedding was in November. The declaration of the Torah approach to homosexuality appeared, and 150, eventually 220 rabbis signed on to a document that was intended to be a stopgap, a kind of like, okay, this is clear. There can be no movement on this question. And so this document basically made the following claim. And I want to be really clear about three different approaches that emerge in the beginning of this decade. One is, I'm going to call it Haredi idealism, which means to say that the law is the law, and there is no engagement with it that could in any way challenge it. And that is going to become a very difficult position to hold, but one that the Orthodox community in its original response to this is going to attempt to stand by, in because it has done so in many other ways in regard to kind of modern challenge. And so this was yet another, like, yes, the conservative movement's permitting driving on Shabbat, but no, we are committed to absolute halachic fealty for 2,000 years. So in order to do this, what their response was that there is no such thing as a homosexual. The very idea that someone is, by definition, born and structured with a sexuality that is different would require a halachic response to that new reality. And therefore, from this position, it was important that to basically claim that there was no such thing as a homosexual. There are no homosexuals. The Torah makes it clear, a clear statement, that homosexual is not an acceptable lifestyle or genuine identity. The genuine identity is really the important thing. By severely prohibiting its conduct, reality obeys ideology. Those are my words. And since reality obeys ideology, there can be no change in the halachic norm. And a homosexually inclined person that can't overcome his homosexuality is an impossibility because behaviors are changeable. The Torah does not forbid something which is impossible to avoid. Now, understand what's exciting about this is that they're recognizing the human reality that would be nearly impossible to respond to thoughtfully if God had created homosexuals and then gave them an impossible task of overcoming it. So the Haredi idealism is aware of the human element and therefore is refusing to admit that it has to be impossible to change. The Torah does not forbid something which is impossible to avoid. Abandoning people to a lifelong loneliness and despair by denying all hope of overcoming and healing their same-sex attraction is heartlessly cruel. Such an attitude violates the biblical prohibition, you shall not place a stumbling block before the blind. The concept that God created a human being who's unable to find happiness in a loving relationship unless he violates a biblical prohibition is not plausible nor acceptable because God is loving and merciful. Struggles, yes, but no, impossible, lifelong prohibited situations, not a, you know, that is not possible. So I want to stop sharing for 1 second and make it clear that this position, I have a soft space in my heart for this position, because this is not a denial of, I would say, of the responsibility of the tradition to be real with people and to respond to real into realities. It is an insistence that because they have a conviction around God and revelation, they know that the last category, which is the human story, has to function in a particular way. The reality has to obey the ideology, because they really feel stuck. So imagine the following three realities. I'm going to give you three statements. One of them has to be false. God is loving, just, good. And God's Torah, God would never give a Torah that was other than that. Right? God gives, you know, the Torah, and all its paths are justice and righteousness and peaceful. Two, the halakha is fixed, and there's no mediation, or even, you know, there's nothing changeable. There's no remediation possible. The halakha is halakha for more than 2,000 years, not going to change. And lastly, you cannot change by therapy or prayer or will a gay person into a straight person. That's not possible. So one of those is false. You can just decide which one. So the Haredi position, they feel forced to choose that the last one has to be wrong, because they do not want to unseat the halachic norm or God's goodness. You heard it in the document. Like, God is good and just and loving and kind. God would never give a law that would subject a human being to a torturous lifelong celibacy that is inhuman. So you've got to be able to change. So what's fascinating is that at a certain juncture, modern Orthodox Jews began to listen to psychologists and eventually to people coming out of the closet, and began to realize that people were not choosing this, nor was it changeable, because therapists, even Orthodox therapists, began to tell them, sorry, but this is not something therapy or will can change. And therefore they were stuck. The moment they dealt with that problem, they were put into a vice of impossible frames of conflict. They had either a bad law or a bad God, and they wanted neither. And so the next category I'm going to share with you is not the idealism of the Haredim that force the reality into the ideal portrayal, but what I call conflicted traditionalism. Now let me share one more time. There you go. I think it's here. Okay. Conflicted traditionalism. So, in 2006, this already began happening in partially in response to the efforts of the Supreme Court, or at least efforts in that way, direct, you know. So homosexual behavior, says Rabbi Tzvi Hirsch, who was the executive president of the Orthodox Union and a psychologist, homosexual behavior between males and females is absolutely forbidden by Jewish law. In the Shulchan Aruch, traditional Jewish law only recognizes a marriage between a man and a woman. But observant Jews must have an attitude of empathy and understanding, right? So that began because the empathy was around the reality of people's frames. I once met Zvi Hirschweinrib at NYU when he gave a session. And he said, like, if a homosexual couple came to my house for Shabbos, I would invite them and welcome them, and they could stay in the same room, but I'm not going to legitimate their behavior. So they were beginning already to struggle in the beginning of the 2000s. Here, and it was this statement in July of 2010, put out by a group of people orchestrated by Rabbi Nathaniel Helfgott. they created something called the Statement of Principles on the Place of Jews with Homosexual Orientation in Our Community. And it got a lot of response. Some people felt it didn't go far enough. Some people thought it went too far, but many people did sign it. The problem was, and I could go into detail here, but the problem was, is that it was filled with self-contradictory material. It was what I call conflicted traditionalists is we're so empathetic. And oh, by the way, no, we can never support your relationships. So the empathy, like in the end, and the commitment to the dignity of homosexuals falls way short of what that would actually mean on the ground. Jews with homosexual orientations or same-sex attractions should be welcomed as full members of the synagogue and school community. But later on, it says, we do not here address what synagogues should actually do about accepting members who are openly practicing homosexuals or living with a same-sex partner. Each synagogue, together with its rabbi, must establish its own standard in regard to membership for open violators of halacha. These people are in trouble because they already, as remember I said, there were three statements. God is good, halacha is unchangeable, and you can't change people. They are recognizing you can't change people. It's unchangeable. And therefore, they are stuck with either this problematic halacha or a theology that's really problematic. And so they are struggling to do the best empathy they can so that at least they become empathetic and nice and kind and just, but they don't really know how to manage difficult biblical rules that articulate divine will or difficult rabbinic decisions that are thousands of years old. I could go into greater detail, but I can tell you that if you read the Statement of Principles and you can look it up on the web, you'll find lots of self-contradictory statements in it. The group of Jews emerging, actually, I would say you could already see it in the early 2000s with Rabbi Shlomo Riskin, but it really took off in 2012. But I want to read Rabbi Riskin's introductory, and Rabbi Riskin has been a leader in this for a long time. He says, in an article written 20 years ago, by the way, I should say that prior to Riskin, I don't have it here, but Norman Lamb wrote an addendum to the Jewish Encyclopedia where he said at least some Orthodox gay Jews could be considered under duress, onus rachmana patre. The merciful one has, he does not hold accountable people who are under duress. So if you're under a duress, someone puts a gun to your head and says, violate Shabbos, you're not held accountable. And if the duress is internal, it's a psychological condition, you're also not fully accountable. And he began to say that at least some homosexuals might be in that category, and therefore we shouldn't hound them or make their life difficult, but it was still prohibited and wrong. So based on this, Riskin takes this a good deal further. He says, how can we deny a human being the expression of his physical and psychic being? If there's a problem with the kettle, blame the manufacturer. Kind of brilliant, right? Is that a person comes and says he's gay, and Rabbi Riskin was leading with this, you know, exciting, cutting edge Orthodox synagogue in the 80s and 90s, and gay people came out to him, and he realized that they were people who were Shomer Mitzvot who wanted to remain connected to the tradition, and he adopted their critique of God. If there's a problem with the kettle, blame the manufacturer. Is it not cruel to condemn an individual from doing that which his biological and genetic makeup demand that he do? It's already doing exactly what the Haredim said you can't do. And the reason they said you can't do it is because he is going then to be troubled to challenge either God or the rabbinic framework. And in this case, he says, the Jewish response would have to be that if an individual is acting out of compulsion, duress, onus, he would not be held culpable. Now, he doesn't go further than that here, but it's the start of this view that there's more that needs to be said about the identity issue here that the halakha is not fully accounting for yet and needs to. So this is, in a way, Riskin's first attempt to claim, no, the halakha has work to do and we haven't done it yet. Kanevsky and others after him have been even clearer. Rabbi Yosef Kanevsky actually was the first Orthodox rabbi. Eshel, one of our very, very first events was a meeting in the congregant during the summer where he sponsored a kind of shalashudis. And I and a few other people came to talk about, to just tell our stories. And 100 people showed up in Los Angeles to listen. He has been a leader in this issue in a bunch of different ways. And he wrote this in 2012. The statement of the RCA, by the way, just prior to that, the RCA did come out with a statement because of legal concerns that if they were held attempting to do therapy, and in New Jersey, it was considered malpractice to do so, change therapy, they didn't want to get involved in any legal battles. So they began to claim that there was no obligation for a homosexual to attempt to change because the broad approach to this question in the psychotherapeutic community was that it was not something ordinarily doable. Yeah, some bisexuals could be pulled toward their heterosexual side, but no, there was no evidence that reparative therapy is effective. Once that was written, Kanevsky wrote this, our community is acknowledging that homosexuality may very well be simply part of the human condition. And accordingly, we've decided that homosexuals should no longer have to pay the psychological, emotional, and even physical price for our theological comfort. We have to, you know, we still have a problem to solve. We have a theological question, right? It's taken. We haven't solved the theological question. What does that mean? We don't know how to talk about God or about halakha quite yet. But we know one thing. The human truths in front of our eyes cannot be denied. This is a deep psychic human identity. And it's very similar to what, you know, what Riskin said, but didn't kind of fill in the detail, is that if the kettle made this, you know, if the kettle is problematic, let's talk to the manufacturer. And this was reiterated following that in a bunch of different ways. Actually, earlier in 2001, when it came out, the boldest statement in the film Trembling Before God by Sandy Dabowski, which many of you might have seen, which kind of started the history of gay orthodoxy in many ways because it told our stories, and even from Haredi perspective, told our stories. He says something in that film, it's not possible for the Torah to come and ask a person to do something which he's unable to do. Theoretically speaking, it might be better for the homosexual to live a life of celibacy. I just do argue one thing, it's completely impossible, it doesn't work. The human force of sexuality is so big, it can't be done. The notion that the command to fight this was not realistic only is on the foundation of this being an identity rather than an illicit desire. When I first came out in 1999, Rabbi Tendler, Mordechai Tendler, wrote a response and said, there's no such thing Rabbi Tendler said, there's no such thing as an Orthodox gay rabbi. To be Orthodox and gay and rabbi is like saying one eats, a cheeseburger on Yom Kippur and is an Orthodox rabbi. So my response was, Rabbi Tendler, firstly, to claim that we have new information about human sexuality that requires us to rethink our response to a circumstance that we didn't fully understand or hasn't existed in the past, to claim that we need to respond to a new mitzias is not heresy. That's one. Two, nobody jumps off a bridge because they want a cheeseburger. Nobody takes Prozac because they want a shrimp cocktail. No one gets electric shock therapy because they, you know, want a shrimp cocktail or a ham sandwich. To deprive a human being of intimacy, love, and companionship for a lifetime, it's not depriving a person of a cheeseburger. So this portrayal of homosexuality as innate began to challenge modern Orthodox rabbis to come up with at least some different public face in regard to their, like, empathy became far more real, in part because Orthodox rabbis, and I don't say this with any glee, they began to realize their obligation to suffer with us. While they did not feel they had the shoulders to transform 2,000 years of halakha, or even to kind of reformulate the divine word, they knew that they held responsibility for something that was horrific, and they did not want to abandon us. They just didn't. They felt disempowered from the system that empowers them as rabbis, and were stuck and wanted to share their stuckness honestly. Let me go back to the text because there's a couple more here. Okay. So I want to say that in Israel, this happened too. And there are kind of elements in Israel that you could do this whole session from an Israeli perspective as well, and you'd have a lot of material. But I do want to say one thing about Rabbi Shurlo is he said, fear dominates religious and political social world, particularly the Orthodox world, fear of gays and reformists and fear of anyone who doesn't think like me. I don't want to live like that. There is an element inside the Orthodox community that is afraid of addressing this question because being real and honest about it will threaten fixities that they don't want to threaten. And a group of younger rabbis are claiming that we cannot sustain an orthodoxy on this kind of fearful approach to the tradition, and it won't sell, you know, in Peoria. And that is exactly what Rabbi Ari Siegel, the head of the school at Shelhevet, an Orthodox school in Los Angeles, said. This may surprise many adults, but the reconciliation of the Torah's discussion of homosexuality represents the single most formidable religious challenge for our young people today. In other words, this issue is not only about gay Jews. It's about their parents. It's about their siblings. It's about their friends. It's about their teachers. More young people are coming out than ever before. And that repeatedly puts a face on this theological challenge. These weighty issues do not live in the abstract. They powerfully, emotionally impact genuine living individuals, individuals living in the Orthodox community, with real life families and friends. What may seem like an interesting sociological debate, in truth, is creating crushing pain, anxiety, and general turmoil for people about whom we deeply care. As they go off to college, students invariably face the painful moral dilemma created by this seemingly intractable conflict. Believing in the primacy and validity of the Torah on one hand, and following their heart's sense of morality with regard to loving and accepting their gay friends, or perhaps coming out themselves on the other, all too often this earnest challenge results in our children quietly losing their faith in the Torah as a moral way of life. So I wanna here share one other document. I think I can share it with my screen, and I'm going to try to do that in a second, but let me explain what it is. Is that so? Eshel, we started Eshel, Miriam Kabakov and I, and the group of friends started Eshel in 2010. And it is a support, advocacy, and education organization. And we work with LGBT Orthodox Jews or people who are ex-Orthodox to support them. You'll see in the chat that we have a support group in Toronto, and it's vibrant, led by Mira Goldstein, and it's just marvelous. And we want to grow it. So we want parents and allies of all kinds to figure out how to, you know, kind of come together and begin to move Orthodox communities from the ground up, as well as rabbis who find themselves, feeling responsible and wanting avenues for doing so within a context of collegial understanding, because we were in contact with 225 Orthodox rabbis of congregations, helping them to navigate this issue in a way that allows them to do so with respect and dignity, but also with responsibility. And so that work is ongoing. But I wanted to, to share with you that we also run a program, you know, a national retreat for parents. And in, I think it's 2018, we did a survey. And the whole survey can be, you know, you can get it on echelonline.org. But I want to share with you at least one page of it that I think speaks volumes. Again, I'm going to share my screen. And now it is, let's see if I can find it here. No, that's Eshel Toronto. Hold on. This is great. You can see the Eshel Toronto thing and you can click on it. But hold on. That's not what I want. New share. Hold on. I want this. No. Hold on. It's not working. Oh, boy. Let me try one more time and see if I can find it. But I may have gotten the wrong link. Is that? Let's see. Nope. Okay. I'm going to have to just share with you a cappella because it seems like I've messed up with the links. But this document, if you reach out to me, if you can't find it on the Eshel website, at steve@eshelonline.org, I will send it to you. But it is a survey of parents. And we asked our parents in 2018, and most of whom are centrist or modern Orthodox, some of whom are Haredi, do they want their kids finding love and companionship? And some 93% said, yeah. In other words, the moment this is real in a human frame, people are just with their feet telling the Orthodox community, I'm sorry, but I'm faithful, and I am simply not going to treat people I love as excluded from the community and as ideally, you know, a challenge to be celibate for a lifetime. And I think that is it's exactly where what I would call the generous Orthodox find themselves. They, I think, are moving slowly towards some even more exciting, you know, reconciliation frames. I want to talk about a little bit of those. But before I do, I'd like to at least entertain a couple of questions at this point, because I think that right now there might be lots of questions that you entertain. I don't know, is this, Cheryl, a good place to open up questions? And then we can end with a little bit more exciting responses from contemporary rabbis.
You're the boss.
Okay, you can put your questions in the chat. I'm happy to take them for about 10 minutes and then we'll see if we can wrap up with some, I think, exciting Orthodox responses.
There was one question already, not content, but there was a curiosity if we might be able to access some of these source sheets when you're done. So I'll ask that while other people are formulating their questions.
Correct. I'm happy to share this entire presentation. And let's see if we can, the best way to do it, because I'd have to kind of gather it now and I'm teaching, I don't want to do it right now, is just be in touch with steve@eshelonline.org. And I'm happy to send you anything you like. And happy to be in touch. Okay. If there are no questions, I'm happy to push forward in order to get lots more done, because there is lots more to do.
I just got a question.
Go ahead.
So the question from Bob says, how do we respond to the stereotypes about Orthodox Jews from non-Jews about Leviticus?
The stereotypes of Orthodox Jews to non-Jews? I'm not so sure what the question is.
If I might try to understand that Leviticus gives non-Jews a specific idea of how Orthodox Jews view homosexuality.
Right. So listen, by the way, they wouldn't be wrong that a significant portion of Orthodox Jews feel that the texts are self-evident. And the reason they do so is because there's a great deal of nervousness around admitting that, and we're going to get to this in the next group of texts, admitting that the biblical text remains open to reapplication. And so there's something deep in this question about where we feel structurally loyal to the past and where we feel structurally loyal to keeping God's Torah responsive and alive to new realities. And that line, we will not agree on that line, but there's no community, none, that says that the law of the past is inevitably eternal. That's just not true, because it's been challenged in multiple circumstances under multiple conditions. It's also not true that every new reality generated a complete reevaluation and reapplication of the tradition, because that's also not true. There are all kinds of things that we resisted modernity, and at least from the Orthodox perspective, wisely. You know, a whole group of Jews decided that the suburbs required us to get rid of the Shabbos prohibitions and driving, and it turns out that among communities that will allow face-to-face community to thrive, and relationships and open Shabbos homes, and like the vibrancy of community, were people who kept Shabbos and therefore walked to shul. In other words, our resistance to modernity is as creative sometimes as our adoption of it. And so that's what makes me Orthodox. I'm not jumping on any bandwagon, but the distinction between where we need to respond and where we need to put resistance up, how long and in what way, is an ongoing challenge. And so what I would say to Christians is, we are not a biblical religion. If you think we are, you misunderstand us. We are a religion whose biblical commitments are always, you know, responded to, reacted, and developed by both a rabbinic and a contemporary frame of interpretive life. And we've done it all, like, this is what Torah Shebaal Peh is. It's the human reaction to the Torah and our inculcation of that to the future, and our sense that there's space for reevaluation. By the way, that's where I want to go in the next 20 minutes. So I'll take one more question. So I want to make it clear that I am addressing specifically LGBT, you know, the L and the G questions, because it would take another more than one session to address the challenge that both trans and genderqueer and bisexual Jews offer this community. Because while politically we are all, you know, gender and sexuality renegades of various kinds, we're all challenging the norms in these areas. We are doing so very differently, with very different cultural and halachic realities, with very different applications. I just think that the trans and the genderqueer non-binary communities need to be listened to and responded to thoughtfully. And I would love to do that work along with a colleague who is trans or and someone non-binary, because I do not think that it's a great idea for me to be representative of that reality, because I think that my voice goes only so far, and I'm happy to be part of that, but I can't respond. All I can say to you is that it's a different challenge, and one that contemporary, the same rabbis that are speaking in the next material that I'm going to share, that are speaking about gay and lesbian Jews, are beginning to write really creatively about the complications around the binary that leaves in the middle a space that is fuzzy and gray and not fully determined, and that the rabbis always had a space for ben hashmashos, not night, not day, always a space for not quite a Jew and not quite a Gentile, the ger toshav is a little of both, and you know, so there's always this possibility of a gray space in between binary. And I think we have beginning a language to address it, but it's not for now. But thank you. I've got a 7-minute warning. I got to run. Hold on. Share screen. So there we go. Okay. So I love this text. I can't help teaching it. In the book of Ecclesiastes, it says, I observed all the oppressions going to the sun, and there are the tears of the oppressed, and there's no one to comfort them. And the hands of their oppressors, there's power, and there's no one to comfort them. And a guy named Daniel, who was a tailor, he responds in Leviticus Rabbah, and he's codified in the Midrash. He says, I know who those insulted ones are. They're the Mamzerim. They're people who are the children of people who committed adultery or incest. And there's, you know, well, he didn't do anything wrong. He's totally innocent. And so who are his oppressors? Those oppressors are the great Sanhedrin of Israel, which move against Mamzerim, who are not permitted to marry into the Jewish congregation, not because of anything they did, because it says a Mamzer shall not enter the congregation of the Lord. So this is Daniel the tailor claiming that the rabbis can become oppressors by just doing what the Torah says. And therefore what happens is, since there's no one to comfort them, God comforts them. This is a fantastic text that challenges the notion that the rabbis just fulfill God's word by claiming that if you're not going to listen to the consequences of the law that you enact, you are becoming an oppressor. Eliezer Berkowitz, and after him others, said the following. One follows with astonishment the boldness of these rabbis who believe that the law of the Torah is divine and yet criticize it in the name of God. And in the end, God realizes the law has to be changed. Bastards will be declared pure, says, you know, the Gemara. God himself will comfort them, says Daniel the tailor. So the halachic way out of this dilemma, according to an Orthodox rabbi from Chicago, Rabbi Eliezer Berkowitz, you can read his book, Torah is not in heaven. It's a great book. The halachic way out of the dilemma was a circumspect application of the law of the Mamzer. Rabbi Yitzchak says, you don't, if a Mamzer is submerged, we really don't, that's not well known who he is. We do not announce it. And in the end, you're not allowed, even if you know someone for sure, not allowed to reveal someone's a Mamzer. Why? They did not believe that running after a Mamzerim was a good idea, because they, in the end, believed that this was a law that, while it's had its purpose at one time, caused too much suffering unnecessarily and, in fact, unfairly. And Rabbi Yisachar Katz, who is a rabbi at Yeshiva Echov Torah, uses this text as well. He says the rabbi's passivity proves that they lack the requisite judicial courage and intellectual creativity to form their roles correctly, and that is why he considers them oppressors. By the way, what's interesting again is that the rabbis could have decided not to canonize Daniel the tailor. They canonized him because they recognized the danger. A posek must always find ways within halacha to reduce suffering. Observant Jews who have same-sex attraction suffer through known fault of their own, just like the mamzer are not allowed to marry and conduct an adult life. And Jewish judicial passivity in the face of such thievery is indefensible. And that is like, this is the new perspective coming out of very thoughtful modern Orthodox rabbis. There's more to say, and I'm going to share this document widely. I'm happy to do so afterwards. But I love this text from Rav Kook. Rav Kook says the following in Arpalei Torah. And this, not exactly sure when this was written, but I believe it's, in the 20s. There are times when there's a need to violate the words of the Torah, since there's no one in the generation who can show the way to do it permissibly. And so it comes as a breach. Sometimes the law, there's no way to get across this new river that's in front of us. It would be much better if such violations of the law came about as unintentional. People unintentionally transgress, and all of a sudden they discover a better path later, because then they're accidental sinners. But nonetheless, we only get change happening legitimately when a prophetic spirit rests upon the people of Israel, and it's possible to fix such matters by legal decrees. In other words, halakha needs a prophetic spirit in order to function effectively, and people are frightened, they're scared, they don't know how to do that. So the matter is addressed, and when that happens, it suggests legitimately. as a straightforward mitzvah. But without that, without the prophecy, the matter is fixed by breaking the law. Some people just go ahead and get married. They go ahead and live lives committed to all the mitzvot and get that they will, you know, they may be accountable for breaking this, but that is how the law will change, is by moving ahead with confidence, trusting that the God of love and commitment and justice is behind us. Remember the three portrayals, God is good and just and loving, and that the law, the halakha, will get there. The rabbis will wake up at some point, just like Daniel the tailor said, the rabbis will get up, you know, God is comforting the moms there and us and saying, look, my children, I love you, I love you. My rabbis will eventually get it, but in the meantime, no, I'm comforting you. The obstruction of the light of prophecy gets in the way. And therefore, when Jews just go ahead and get married and celebrate and live traditional Jewish lives, then it might sadden the heart because it looks like it's a violation, but it gladdens the heart because of its inner essence. The fear of heaven later on, the cook says, should never overtake natural morality of human beings. For if it does, then it isn't pure fear of heaven. The sign of one's pure fear of heaven is when natural morality, planted in the basic nature of a person, rises in virtue in increasing measures, higher than it would otherwise. But if fear of heaven is depicted as such, that without its influence, life would function better. And if the circumstances of both individuals and collective would be better without it, then when its presence is influenced, then and when its presence existed, when that kind of fear of heaven exists, it diminishes life, that sort of fear of heaven is flawed. I leave you with the sense that there's lots of room, but that whether, you know, people like me and our Orthodox queer friends have the patience to stay is something that only individuals can answer. If people say, I'm sorry, Rabbi, but I can't bear it, I'm leaving, I totally understand. But let me say this, is that, you know, I came out in 1999, and a few weeks later, walking in the street on Shabbos in New York City, in 93rd Street, some Jew started screaming at me, coming out of shul, you're the public homosexual, you're the chayti umachti, the sinner, who caused her the sin, go back to the bars and the clubs where you belong, you disgusting piece of garbage, you tayeva. And in my mind, it was a crowd forming, in my mind, I remembered my karate teacher, NYU, sober, Mar Sober, and he said, when a punch comes, just don't be at the point of impact, step away. And I saw all these words running beside me, and I realized he was yelling at a figment of his imagination, at a monster he feared, not me. So I calmly said to him, my dear friend, I'm afraid I'll be your worst nightmare. Because, you know, I go to the bars and clubs, it's just not my scene. I go to Orthodox synagogues, and you know, I have 100 gay Orthodox friends. It's a little exaggeration, but I had 100 gay Orthodox friends, and we will find partners and produce babies, and we're going to push our baby carriages into your shul and look at me. We will not leave. And he freaked out and walked away. The only thing, you only get to change what you love. And so it's legitimate to leave. But then the possibility of actually moving halachic Judaism forward diminishes. And so while I don't believe it's appropriate for everyone to do this, I do believe that that's the mission that I've kind of dedicated myself to in a complex way. And I hope I've been able to articulate some of that today. And I'm happy to hear from any of you afterwards at steve@eshelonline.org. And happy to take one last question, I guess, if there's 1 minute.
Unfortunately, we don't have time for one more question. We've got people coming in for our next session, but I want to thank you so much, Rabbi. This has been really, really enlightening. And I know that a lot of us got a lot out of this session. So thank you for your presentation. Thank you to everyone for your questions and your participation. I know there are some people here for the next session already, but I actually am going to close the room, so you'll have to come back in a moment. But thank you everyone so much, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your time here at Limud. Thank you, Rabbi.